He said, man, how do you listen to stuff? It's really scary. And I said, you know, I know the end, right? I know how this all ends.
He brought to my attention was the regathering of Israel. It's very possible that the end time scenario can be triggered because they are regathered into the land. That's one of the prerequisites for the second coming.
That's one thing I don't understand. The book of Revelation is the only book in the Bible that promises a blessing to those who read it. So why isn't it largely being studied? You know, it's the back of the book. It's the end of the story. It's Christ's victory. Why is this book so highly ignored?
We will go ahead and get started here. It's been an interesting morning, to say the least. My life has been kind of crazy. Officially moved into my new house. I'm officially a country boy, kind of. We live out in Smithville now, so I'm out of the big city. So we're going to do something a little bit different here. Every morning a majority of the mornings I like to talk with you guys about things going on in the headlines. And some of you may like that, some of you may not. But I was praying through some things this week, and as I was praying through some things, I kind of got some things that popped into my head, and I'm hoping that it's from the Holy Spirit. It's either from the Holy Spirit or I'm crazy, one of the two. So I wanted to share some with you guys as I was praying, and I kind of got confirmation on this, but you know, when we look at what's going on in the news, when we look at what's going on in the world, when we look at just everything that's going down, I keep wondering what the world is being set up for. You know, I keep wondering, like, why are we all being guided someplace? And I kind of think that I get the bigger picture. And one of the things that popped into my head was, you know, the Bible clearly says that human beings are, to put it bluntly, we're kind of sheep, right? We follow. We are made with a God-shaped hole in our heart. That's why if you don't find Jesus, you're always going to look for something to worship. You're always going to look for something to follow. You're always going to look for an idol. So that's why the Bible kind of calls us sheep, right? But what's kind of interesting is Satan knows that humankind has this shepherd flocking mentality, right? So I was just Googling herding, and some things really stuck out to me. That I wanted to share with you guys, and this is from Wikipedia. But herding is the act of bringing individual animals together into a group, maintaining the group, and moving the group from place to place. Now, I want you guys to understand something that I do believe, obviously, from the way we see prophecy and the way we look at the book of Revelation and the Bible in the past, I do believe that Satan wants to lead mankind somewhere, right? He wants to lead them into worship away from the one true God. And we know from Isaiah 14 and Ezekiel 28 that Satan wants the worship, and he wants to kind of take control of people. So he's also interested in getting this group to move from place to place and from gathering everyone to one. Once again, we saw that in where? The Tower of Babel, right? Where he kind of set up this false world religion where he gathered everyone to himself. And once again, we see that replay out in the book of Revelation. So, moving the group from place to place or any combination of those. Herding can refer either to the process of animals forming herds in the wild or to human intervention forming herds for some purpose. It's amazing. I see many applications biblically to both of these, right? Think about this. Herding, process of animals forming herds in the wild. How many times do we just see the world kind of get in a set pattern or a set idea, and everybody just goes along with it, right? Naturally, if it's popular, if it's in, we're going to follow that, right? That's the herding mentality that's inside of us instinctively. We want to follow where the big group leads, right? And Scripture clearly says that broad is the path that leads to destruction. So we as believers need to realize that we aren't just called to go wherever the herd goes. We aren't called to instinctively just follow the popular culture. But the interesting thing to me here, another process of herding is by human intervention forming herds. So we see these shepherds, they kind of guide the the sheep into the fold, right? What I want you guys to understand is I believe what Satan is doing here in the end times is he is gathering everyone together, and he's doing it through very specific means. One of the greatest means that he's gathering us all together here in this time is fear, right? Terrorist attacks, economy collapsing, Ebola viruses, you name it. He's gathering everyone together for some purpose, and I'm going to kind of give you an idea what I think that is. A group of animals fleeing a predator will demonstrate herd behavior for protection. Once again, do you guys see how that kind of lays exactly into what I'm talking about? We see these terrorist attacks, we see Ebola, we see so on and so forth. So we're all kind of collectively being herded together for protection, what we think is protection. And isn't it interesting that Scripture in Zechariah 11, verse 17, many theologians, many commentators say that this is actually a description of the Antichrist in the end times. And someday maybe we'll discuss Zechariah 11, but woe to the worthless shepherd. Some translations call him the idle shepherd, but the worthless shepherd who leaves the flock. A sword shall be against his arm and against his right eye. His arm shall completely wither, and his right eye shall be totally blinded. But once again, we see him called the worthless shepherd. Satan, through the end times, is going to gather the entire world under this worthless shepherd. Now, why do I say all this? What's the point of all of this that I'm even bringing up today? John 10, verse 11 and 14, Jesus says, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life for the sheep. I am the good shepherd, and I know my sheep, and I am known by my own. So in the midst of all this chaos, in the midst of all this turmoil, in the midst of the terrorist attacks, in the midst of wherever the crowd is going, we as believers are called to listen to the good shepherd, right? We are, as believers, are called to listen for that still small voice of Jesus. So think about it. The world right now, what's the big idea? The big idea right now is, what do we do with all these refugees, right? And I like to stir the pot to get you guys thinking, but once again, what does the world say about it? Where are we being led to it? And that's why we as believers need to prayerfully take this to the Father. We need to prayerfully listen for the voice of Jesus and follow where these things go. As we see these times that we're living in continue to play out, we want to follow the good shepherd. We don't want to follow the news media outlets, right? Finally, most assuredly I say to you, he who does not enter the sheepfold by the door, but climbs up some other way, the same as a thief and a robber, but he who enters the door is the shepherd of the sheep. So once again, you see Jesus constantly telling us and reminding us that he's the one who's going to lead us. David in Psalm 23, one of my favorite psalms, I'm sure it's one of your guys' too, God is the good shepherd, right? He's the one who leads us. To him the doorkeeper opens and the sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. And when he brings out his sheep, he goes before them. See, he's leading us, and the sheep follow him, for they know his voice. So once again, I guess my exhortation for you today is to really, we live in crazy times, you know. There's no doubt about it. We need to really be listening for the voice of Jesus. So the reason I bring all this up, the reason why every morning I start with 5 to 10 minutes of prophecy in the headlines, this is why, is because I want us as a group of believers to kind of see where the sheepfold is being led, and we need to try to figure out together how we listen to Jesus through that. Does that make sense? That's all I got about that. There's my morning rant. That was fresh off the press too. Like, I was literally doing that. That's why I was a little bit late. But that's just kind of some of the things that were on my heart, and hopefully that's from the Holy Spirit. But we will pray and we will get started with this new lesson today.
Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the ability just to gather here this morning and just be in fellowship with you in peace and in relative safety. And we don't take that for granted, so we just want to thank you for that this morning. We ask that you would open up your word to us this morning, Father, that you would teach us through our teacher today and really open up our hearts for the wisdom and the knowledge that you have for us today. We also want to ask for discernment, Father, and your discernment for these times that we're facing now with everything we're being bombarded with, all the imagery that the world is putting in front of our eyes. Just give us discernment to cut through it and to see it from your perspective and to allow us to respond the way you would have us respond today. We love you, and it's in Jesus' name that we pray.
Amen. Did it flash? No, we're still good. Okay. So by real quick review, we are in the condemnation. We're still stuck here. We're almost out of here, I promise. But we were studying this verse last week. We spent the entire day on, I will kill her children with death. And this is speaking of that woman Jezebel here in Thyatira. And all the churches shall know that I am he who searches the hearts and the minds. So I'm going to summarize our entire class last week real quick here. The her in parentheses here is bigger than just this prophetess who was alive in 95 AD. Okay. We believe that the her represents Mystery Babylon. And we kind of have spent a long time really getting to that. And once again, we'll see why that's important. The children here that Jesus has in view is greater than just these children that were alive in 95 AD. The children here are in view, as we believe, is a metaphor for future adherence to this Mystery Babylonian doctrine. Okay, and we're going to discover what this Mystery Babylonian doctrine fully is here very soon. But that's a summary of what we've spent a long time going over. But once again, that sentence right there is one of the most confusing sentences in the entire book of Revelation. So I don't feel bad spending a lot of time on it. I will kill her children with death, and all the churches shall know that I am he who searches the heart, the minds and the hearts. So once again, we're going to finish. If you guys have your sheets of paper for the Mystery Babylon paper, if anybody didn't get that and they want a copy of that, you can raise your hand. Derek's got some extra. But we're going to finish looking at the progression of Mystery Babylon throughout human history. And once again, guys, I want you to get that the reason why this is so important, this is a list I compiled of just what I've heard or what I've studied or what other theologians have said Mystery Babylon represents. The United States, the Roman Catholic Church, apostate Christianity, Europe, Rome, Jerusalem, Iraq, Saudi Arabia, radical Islam, you name it. Many theologians have said that this is what Mystery Babylon is. And what we believe is Mystery Babylon is bigger than any one of those things. We believe Mystery Babylon encompasses all those things, actually, if you want to get down to it. But it's much bigger than that. And we'll discuss that more thoroughly as we get to it. But what's really cool is that by studying this woman Jezebel and spending so much time on Mystery Babylon, you guys will be able to fully get what Mystery Babylon is. So we're going to finalize this sentence here. Jesus says that I will kill her children with death, and all the churches shall know that I am he who searches the minds and the hearts. Okay, so I want you guys to get, this is kind of one of the most important final sentences here in this condemnation to the letter of Thyatira, and we'll see why here. The Greek word for mind is nephros, and it's only used one time in the entire New Testament, so it's not an easy word to track down, but The way I kind of look at it is like when we say, man, that person has guts, right? It's kind of like their inside, their being, who they really are, what's up here, what's down here, what's everywhere, just kind of what makes that person who they are, their innermost thoughts. But Jesus is once again showing us here that our mind, our will, our emotions, all of it are important, right? Not just our heart, not just our mind, but both of them. Doctrine plus devotion. You guys have heard me talk about this over and over again, right? Doctrine is kind of like the nerd aspect of theologies. What teachings do we believe in that the Bible teach? What teachings do we believe that Jesus is saying? Head knowledge, right? Doctrine, you really think a lot of head knowledge. But once again, Jesus is also saying that your inner being, that portion of who you are, that love towards me, that devotion is also in focus. So we have to always have both the mind and the heart. Jesus is bringing in focus here. So Jesus is kind of pointing us to a focal point here. And one of the main things that I want you guys to get in this entire letter is that Jesus sees through what we'll call external religion. When you cut down to Mystery Babylon and all of its tenets, really what it is, it's an external religion, right? It's not a transformative religion on the inside. And I use religion very loosely there, but it's external, right? It's nothing that happens on the inside of the person. And we read clearly from Scripture that God has to transform us from the inside, not external religion. So we've already discussed there the mind and the heart, the doctrine and the devotion are both essential. Whenever we see Jesus putting special emphasis on the mind and the heart, he's saying it's all important, mind and heart. And I made a note here. I don't fully understand what I was saying here. Sometimes I make notes and I don't really know why I put it there, but it is. I do kind of get what I'm saying. Salvation is a mystery, and I say this all the time. Wouldn't it be really cool if we all, when you trust Jesus, you get like this external mark on your head or something or on your hand, and you just knew that whoever you're talking to is really saved? You know, wouldn't that be kind of cool? We always make jokes like we think that there's going to be a lot of people in heaven that we didn't think would be there, and we also think there will be a lot of people who aren't in heaven who we thought would be there, right? Salvation is kind of a mystery. That's, once again, one of my favorite life verses is Paul when he says, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. He doesn't say work for your salvation. He says work out. This is really important to me because I struggled with my salvation for 2-3 years when I first became a Christian. Derek was a big part of that. He saw me struggle with how can you be sure that you're saved, right? And once the final conclusion that I came to is how can you know if you're saved? If you really want to test yourself to know if you're saved, one of the things you ultimately have to come to the conclusion of is who do you trust? You know, is it you putting trust in you making sure that you're saved? Because if it is, you're in the wrong boat. And that's what I tried to do for a long time, right? If you're putting any trust in you, that's scary. Now, I had to finally just come to the end of myself and I said, you know what, Lord? I put all my chips in your hand. When I die, I put my trust in Jesus and so on and so forth. That's how I really finally got that inner conviction that I was saved. When I realized that it's not anything I do, it's not anything I maintain, it's all God, it's all Jesus, it's all in the Bible, it's God's word, that's my rock. So anyways, mind and the heart, salvation is a mystery. So, let's put this whole sentence really quickly in perspective, because once again, Jesus says, I will kill her children with death, and all the churches shall know that I am he who searches the minds and the hearts. So, for some reason, somehow, the church is going to see this slaughter of children, and it's going to reveal to people a truth about Jesus, okay? Now, I'm not necessarily saying that I have this all figured out, but I know one thing that we can deduce when the church sees this judgment of Mystery Babylon, and when it sees this judgment on the metaphorical children, we know one thing, that you can't be saved through wrong doctrine, okay? And let me explain what I mean by that. You see in parentheses I put, it depends on the starting point. We've already looked at the fact that it's possible that we as believers, we can be influenced by this woman Jezebel, right? And it says she can lead us and she can seduce us, and we can be led into idolatry from her. Now, I don't think that we can lose our salvation from her, okay? So what I'm trying to say is it depends on the starting point. If you get truly saved from the gospel, you know, and we know the gospel from 1 Corinthians 15, right? Jesus died for our sins. He rose from the grave. We put our trust in him. You believe that? Simple. You're saved. It's over. Now, that's the starting point, though. What about people who are captured in a mystery Babylonian system that never truly hear the gospel that they're a sinner, that they need Jesus Christ as their Savior, that they need to fully put their trust in him, and they continue to do this external religion, right? You can't be saved from wrong doctrine. And we'll look at what some of these wrong doctrines are, but does that make sense at all? That you can't be saved from wrong doctrine, right? There are, believe it or not, there are churches today, quote, churches that are teaching wrong doctrine that aren't even allowing people to hear the true gospel of Jesus Christ. I know that's weird for us to think about here because we hear Pastor and Brandon preach about sin and about Jesus and about salvation all the time, but believe it or not, a lot of churches today don't talk about that, okay? But anyways, killing Jezebel's offspring will reveal a truth to invisible church. So when we see this destruction of Mystery Babylon, we'll realize that those people weren't saved. They didn't have the proper doctrine. And finally, when Jesus says this here, when he says, I am he who searches the minds and the hearts, I believe that Jesus is once again pointing to his divinity. He constantly goes back to, in this letter, this church gets it wrong, gets a lot of things wrong about his divinity, and he's constantly leading us back to the fact that he is God. And let me show you how I discovered this. So here we see Revelation 2, verse 23. I am he who searches the minds and hearts, and I will give to each one of you according to your works. Jesus is stating that. Check this out earlier in Jeremiah 17, verse 10. I, the Lord, search the heart. I test the mind, even to give every man according to his ways, according to the fruit of his doing. Do you guys see how that's almost word for word exactly what's stated in the Old Testament? Okay, just so you guys know, the Lord right there, that's the Hebrew word. It's the, what we call the tetragrammaton. It's we don't even necessarily know how that word is pronounced. Anytime you see in your Bible the Lord and you see Lord in all caps, that's actually the tetragrammaton, which is made up of four Hebrew letters, the Yod, He, Vav, He. We have many translations as to what that sounds like, whether it's Yehovah, Jehovah, so on and so forth. But this name was so holy that we technically don't know exactly how it's spelled.
Those are good Jehovah's Witness verses, by the way, to point them that Jehovah says that he's the one who searches the heart and minds. You can ask them who that is. They'll say Jehovah. Then point them to the Revelation verse. Say, okay, well, who's this searching heart and minds? Same person. Just throwing that out there.
Well, you see a lot with Revelation chapter 1, 2, and 3.
Yeah.
And Revelation 22, Christ gives himself a lot of titles that you can search the Bible through and see that they're applied to God only.
Absolutely.
Well, they say Jehovah's God. They say that.
Yeah, and then you go to Revelation and it says, and Jehovah God says that he died.
Yeah.
You know, so when does Jehovah God die? Oh. And we know Jehovah God died on the cross, right? So that's where you lead them. But once again, isn't it just kind of interesting that those I am verses that we're discussing, where Jesus is pointing to his divinity, if you don't really know your Old Testament, you just kind of glance over this, where Jesus says, I am he who searches the hearts and the minds, not knowing that he's directly quoting from Jeremiah, where he is basically saying, I am. This is another one of those key I am statements there. It's the existing one. And once again, Jesus is showing he's in charge. You're going to see multiple times when we keep going with this letter that he's showing in contrast to this queen of heaven. I've got some things that will blow your guys' mind as we move forward. But once again, Jesus is showing that he is in charge. Okay. I will give to each one of you according to your works. So this is the final sentence of the condemnation, and then we're through it, finally. I completely forgot. What was I doing? Here, I have to go back here. Man. Okay, so let's pull out our charts. That's what we were going to do. Before we finished, we were going to discuss this mystery Babylon. Because last week I got through the left side. So you'll notice that we have three aspects to mystery Babylon that I'm looking at here. You have the personage, the progression, and finally a penalty. And any good pastor or teacher always starts with the same letter. It's like a rule. PPP. The personage, progression, penalty. So I made that up on purpose. So last week we looked at kind of the personage. And like I said, I've laid this all on a timeline for you. Okay, I've laid this on a timeline so you can kind of sort all that out. Satan was the original fall, the original rebel we talked about last week, Semiramis. We don't really know her name from the Bible. We know the name Semiramis from secular literature, but we know that she's called the Queen of Heaven. And like I said, you can search her out in Jeremiah 7, Jeremiah 44. We see the Jezebel of the Old Testament. We talked extensively about her. And finally down here, we see the Jezebel of Thyatira. That's the one we've spent a lot of time on here. And we, once again, the conclusion that we looked at here highlighted is that she is a metaphor for Mystery Babylon. Finally, the children of Jezebel, they are the metaphoric spiritual offspring of Jezebel. These children of Jezebel are the ones who are going to be holding her doctrines. And as we see going forward here, the doctrines of Jezebel have another name. They're called the deep things of Satan. So it's kind of a big deal for us to learn what the deep things of Satan are. Okay, so real quick, let's look at the progression. Remember, we spent a long time here, but we know that Satan originally fell. There's actually some dispute as to when that happened, what that happened, how it happened exactly, but I hold to the thought that Satan fell before Adam and Eve were created. Some people think that he fell at the time Adam and Eve were created. But anyway, so we had the original fall. We had the rebellion of God and his ways. Notice there that I put the corrupted Maseroth. Once again, I spent a lot of time discussing this Maseroth. We believe that God told the gospel in the stars before time. That's why every ancient history, every ancient culture has a lot of the same signs in the heavens. They have the same number of constellations. They have all this, so on and so forth, because we believe that was originally given to Adam, kind of a gospel in the stars that was telling basically about Jesus. You know, it starts with the virgin birth and it ends with Jesus coming as king. But we see that these fallen angels, and we discussed it heavily, Genesis 6, fallen angels come down and they corrupted mankind. They started teaching them hidden spiritual things. That's what we call the occult, still in practice today. Finally, we see the flood happen, and then we really begin to get into Mystery Babylon here. So Mystery Babylon begins with Nimrod here, okay? The Tower of Babel, the one world religion was beginning. We saw that right there. So now we see hidden knowledge is now dispersed through a priesthood. We originally see a priesthood come into being, come into play at the one world religion Tower of Babel. Finally, Mystery Babylon continues to move on through Jezebel of the Old Testament. Remember that Jezebel married Ahab, king of Israel. Okay, they once again attempted a one world religion. That one might be a little bit deceptive for you guys to understand. Here's what you guys got to get. God, through the Jews, set up what's called a theocracy. It's the only time in the Bible that a God-instilled theocracy is set up. A theocracy means that God says, go out, conquer the world in my name. Okay, and he didn't just say, go and kill everybody by the sword, make them convert or die, but he did set up a theocracy to where Israel was supposed to represent him on earth, and they were called to go conquer the lands in the name of Jehovah God. Okay, so Satan, being tricky as he was, he wanted to infiltrate that theocracy, and that's what he began to do with Jezebel. He wanted to take over the world through Israel by this Mystery Babylon entering into Israel. Finally, what we're at here with Revelation 20, Mystery Babylon infects the church. I believe that what's in view when Jesus is talking about in Thyatira, Mystery Babylon infects the church. And notice now that I have in parentheses here, spiritual one world religion. Okay, we really see the birth of this one world in a spiritual sense. You guys are going to hear a big fancy word called ecumenism. All religions are the same. All gods lead to heaven, so on and so forth. That's a Mystery Babylonian doctrine, just so you guys know. Ecumenism, saying that all roads lead to heaven, that's a deep thing of Satan. That's a lie. Coexist. You guys see the bumper sticker, right? Coexist. All roads lead to heaven. Just so you guys know, I'll give you a spoiler. That's one of the deep doctrines of Satan, is that all roads lead to heaven. It's clearly contradicted in the Bible. Okay, finally, Mystery Babylon is fully manifested in the tribulation. Okay, during the 7-year tribulation on earth, there is going to be a period of enforced religion upon the world. I believe we are seeing the setting of it right now. Once again, I've been trying to tell you guys, watch what's going on with this terrorist attacks. Watch what's going on. Really pay attention to what's going on, because what's beginning to rise is a hostility within people towards religion, right? Towards external religion. I believe that one of the initial phases of Mystery Babylon in the seven-year tribulation is going to be that all religions are equal. All religions lead to heaven. It doesn't matter what you follow, right? As long as you say all religions are the same, that ecumenism, okay? I believe that is the initial phase of Mystery Babylon that's going to be enforced by the world in this tribulation. They're basically going to say, if you say Jesus is the only way, that's hate speech, your head's chopped off. Does that make sense? If you say that, you are judging someone else. You are looking down on someone else. Do you see how all this is starting to already play? I mean, it's crazy. Anything to add on that?
Well, you see all the Pray for Paris stuff. And there's a football player who plays for the Saints. He's tight end. But Benjamin Watson. He had the perfect tweet. He tweeted out that we're so quickly to say pray for Paris, but this is the same collective voice that also condemned a football coach for praying after a game.
Mm.
It's a contradiction.
It's deep.
It's crazy, and it's goes back to what Chuck was saying earlier about that hurting mentality.
Mm.
You know, it's like what bandwagon do they want you to jump on at the moment? It's you know, we have eyes to see that, you know, and the world really doesn't. You know, unfortunately, liberalism is an ideology that's pervading the country. You know, it's pretty scary stuff. But
so, when you study the Book of Revelation, this judgment of Mystery Babylon, it's called the harlot. Okay, harlot means that there is many sexual partners. Right, that's kind of this idea of ecumenism. All these religions, we can kind of mishmash them and put them together. That's that harlot religion. So you notice there, I put harlot religion. Also, by the time we get to the sixth seal in the book of Revelation, we already see lots and lots of martyrs just by the time we get to the sixth seal. And when we start breaking these seals, you'll see it happens really fast here in the beginning. There's going to be a lot of people that are killed initially in that seven-year period. It says they held the testimony of Jesus Christ. What'd I do? Oh. Okay. So then finally we see Mystery Babylon, and its final judgment is often personified as the Queen of Heaven. So I bring you guys all the way down there through the bottom. And we don't have to go over the whole right side. I don't got time. But just so you know, each stage of Mystery Babylon, as it progresses throughout time, we see a massive judgment by God. Okay, I say the penalty over there. Once again, we see Satan and God in a chess match. It's kind of hard to play chess match with a guy who owns the board, right? And who knows your move before he's going to make it. But we always see God do a penalty over here. So whether when Mystery Babylon began with Nimrod, then God disperses their tongues. He changed their tongues. Everybody's language disperses them. Jezebel tries to take over the world through Israel. So what does God do? He literally wipes out all of Jezebel's literal adherents. Finally, Mystery Babylon infects the world with this spiritual oneness, this ecumenism that we're going to see. And what does God do? He sends Jezebel into a sickbed, and all those who hold to this false religious system will be killed with death. So that's kind of it. That's that. That's that chart. And like I said, I hope that that helps, because I know we covered a lot of confusing stuff with that. So let's finish this so I can be done with it. I got like 2 minutes and I can get through it. I will give to each one of you according to your works. So that's how Jesus ends the condemnation. I will give to each one of you according to your works. Once again, notice there, works, right? Works is in play here. Five times in this letter, the Greek word ergon for works is in view. We're seeing a lot of different ideas of true works, true religion versus false works, false religion. That's what pastor's preaching on right now in the book of James, right? You say you're a Christian, the book of James, I think James was a Missourian, right? He says, show me your faith. You say you're, she liked that. You said you're a Christian, well, show me. Okay, I will give each one of you according to your works. So once again, we see kind of two people in view of this letter. Some are saved, some aren't saved. Jesus is smart. He's writing this letter knowing that saved and unsaved people are going to read this. So is Jesus talking here to the saved or to the unsaved? My answer is both. It doesn't matter, okay? Both works, both sets of works, whether you're saved or unsaved, will be judged. And I don't have to spend a lot of time on this because we've already taught on this. Both sets of people, long story short, if you're saved or unsaved, you're going to meet at one of two places for a judgment of God. You're going to meet at the Bema Seat judgment, or you're going to meet at the Great White Throne. I promise you, you do not want to be at the Great White Throne, right? If you're at the Great White Throne, there's no hope. Okay, when by the time you get to the Great White Throne, there is no defense. You aren't speaking your defense to God. You are literally sitting, the books are open, and your judgment is pronounced. The Bema Seat is where we all in this room will be. The Bema Seat is where we want to be. That's where we are rewarded for our works. And once again, this is a topic that isn't taught in a whole lot of churches, but what you do with your salvation matters. Those are the works that Jesus cares about. And believe me, those of you who do stuff with your salvation, whether that's witnessing, whether that's supporting the church, whether that's cleaning the bathrooms of the church, whether that's whatever, you will be greatly rewarded in the life to come. And that is why Jesus constantly reminds us that we are heavenly-minded people and that we are to be focusing on the life to come, not just bogged down here on this earth. But notice the contrast there. The Bema Seat, the main emphasis of this judgment will be rewards for the believer. The Great White Throne, the main emphasis of this judgment will be the degree of punishment for the unbeliever. Believe it or not, once again, that's another doctrine that's not commonly taught. There will be different degrees of punishment for unbelievers. So that's the judgment of works. And once again, when Jesus says in that last statement, I will give to each one of you according to your works, he can say that to both believers and unbelievers alike. So it's a multifaceted sentence. And that wraps up the condemnation. I know it's crazy. We will finally be at the exhortation. I'll read it to you here. It's the fifth part, so you guys can get excited about it. This is the exhortation. So Jesus laid out all this stuff, and then he says, the exhortation is, now you do this, okay? Now go do this. Now to you I say, and to the rest in Thyatira, as many as do not have this doctrine, who will have not known the depths of Satan, as they say, I will put on you no other burden, but hold fast what you have till I come. We're going to have a lot of fun with those two. Is that one sentence? Dang, that's one. No, that's two. We're going to have a lot of fun with those two sentences, but they're really cool. So let's pray and get out of here. Father, we thank you for your word. Jesus, we thank you that you are the good shepherd. We thank you that you are constantly calling us. We thank you that you are constantly whispering to us. God, we pray that you would really help us through these times that we live in. We live in interesting times, and we know that we need to listen for your voice. So help us to hear you more clearly. Prepare our hearts and our minds for what you have for us today. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Enjoyed our presentations or felt led by the Lord, please feel free to donate at esfirst.org.